From the United Nations office to the African Union, this is She Stands for Peace, a podcast series where I explore the state of the women, peace and security agenda in Africa through a series of conversations with key actors. In the podcast, we ask the central question, 20 years after UNSCR 1325, how far have we come? I am Dr. Yemisi Akinbobola, your host, and today I'm joined by Candice Mama, author and speaker on trauma, forgiveness, and reconciliation. Candice joins me from Cape Town, South Africa, and we have a conversation of her experience of trauma, forgiveness, and reconciliation. Candice Mama, it's a pleasure to talk to you today. Now, you're known for your work in forgiveness, reconciliation, and trauma. Tell us how you started that journey.
Hi, Yemisi. Oh, such a privilege to be here. Thank you so much for having me. Yes, so how I started is actually very unconventional. This is not a path I signed up for necessarily. It's not something I thought, hey, when I grow up, I'm going to be a forgiveness advocate. You know what I'm saying? But how it happened, unfortunately, is when I was 9 months, my father was murdered by an apartheid assassin by the name of Eugene de Kock. And when I was 25, I actually met Eugene in prison and I advocated for his parole, which he got. And of course, this made international news, especially locally. People were like, what? Like, how could you forgive this person? But as I started to speak about it, what I realized is how many people were actually living in pain. And so that's how my journey slowly started, hesitantly. I mean, I was only 25 at the time, but that's how I ended up really in this work of trauma and reconciliation.
Okay. So I was reading your reflection on the conference that you attended on intergenerational trauma and mental health. And about that topic, you said that you believe the problem stems from the lack of understanding of past conflicts and reimagining what exactly occurred. So, and you attribute this to poor historical education and inadequate debriefing of those who had been directly affected by conflict. So tell us more about your reflections on the importance of accurate representation of history in education when it comes to conflict and peace building approaches, particularly when we think about young girls and boys.
I mean, that question always gives me chills because I'm so passionate about it. I think it is incredible to me in our own country, which is South Africa, how few people, I mean, the younger they get, the less they know, right? And so I remember once I went to a university. I think I was 26 at the time, which is about 3 years ago. And I was giving this talk, you know, and I shoot my story, of course, and I go on. And I remember there was a Q&A portion. And as, you know, I'm taking questions, a young black man, I think he was only like 19, probably, he stands up and he says, hi, you know, thank you so much for sharing your story. But apartheid is over. Shouldn't we just get over it? And so, like, first it took me a little aback, but luckily I've got good media training, so my face was good. poker face. But I remember I asked him a question and I said, if you don't mind me asking, what does your family do? And he said, my mother's a domestic helper and my dad died, you know. And I was like, how did your dad pass away? And he said, no, it's not apartheid related. He was just like an alcoholic and da-da-da-da. And so as I continued to ask him questions, I said, do you think your mother's in her situation because, you know, she just didn't work hard enough? Like, why do you believe your mother's a domestic helper? And he said, you know what? We all get our lot in life. And so I went on to break down what that lot was for many black South Africans. And I said, well, did you know that black South Africans, colored South Africans, it wasn't just like, oh, you sit over there or you live over there. It was a physical breakdown. It was a financial breakdown. And it was also the compactness of the environments that black people had to live in. And also the dehumanization of black women and black men and how black men were berated in front of black women. And that has been proven time and time again. That is what rose the gender-based violence statistics, especially during that era. And so as I continued to explain it, all of a sudden, you know, he was like, oh my goodness, I never thought of it. You know, I didn't even think about that. I didn't attribute my, where I am in life as a based on our past. And as I started moving through life, I've got a younger brother, he's 22 now. And I'd speak to his friends and none of them knew what happened in our country. I mean, they just knew the footnotes, you know, like Nelson Mandela's our big footnote, 1994's our big footnote. And all they attribute the past to is oh, it was violent. It was like, you know, but it's the past. It was just black people over here, white people over there. And in many ways, I do blame our historical education, because when I went to high school, I remember I was just taught that literally I once did an essay and I cringe at it now, but I think I was like 10 and we had to do, you know, who our heroes in history are. And I literally chose F.W. de Klerk and Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela featured very little in that whole talk. And I was like, oh, F.W. de Klerk, you know, he gave over the country and he realized how oppressing black people was so wrong. And I realized that it was because of how we were taught history, that that was our narration of history, that F.W. de Klerk had a come to Jesus moment and he just handed over the country very peacefully. And as we've come to know, he had no choice, unfortunately. You know, it's not like he had already committed a lot of atrocities before we got to the handover phase. He had already initiated so many targets and hits before we transitioned. And my father died under his rule, under his government. So it's very interesting to me how we have stopped giving correct historical information. And I'll close it off with the following. I love this quote, which is, until the hunter knows how to write, or something along those lines. But it's basically, until we know how to tell our own stories, the story will always be told from the side of the victor, right? And I think that's exactly what's happened. And I think that's why South Africa is now experiencing these huge racial undertones, these huge racial undercurrents that haven't happened in a long time. But the past 3 or 4 years, it's been such a big conversation, because all of a sudden people are saying, wait a minute, why am I still not climbing up the corporate ladder? Why am I still paying off the debts of my forefathers? Why am I still in this situation? And so for me, Yemisi, I think it is so incredibly important that we highlight in every country, we highlight the importance of historical education, because until we can accept what was, we will never be able to fix what can be, and we can never move forward in a way where everyone feels acknowledged and seen.
Your traumatic memory was that of the brutal murder of your father by Hugin de Kock, which you mentioned earlier on. And de Kock was a former South African police colonel, infamously known as Primeval. And he was serving a life sentence of 212 years for crimes against humanity, murder, attempted murder, kidnapping, and so on. And this was before you then wrote that letter where you begged for his parole. In your piece that you wrote for She Stands for Peace book by the UNOAU and the African Union, you said that he had robbed me of a father and had subconsciously given him 16 years of anger, anguish, sleepless nights, and bouts of severe depression, as well as suicide attempts. Then one day, I just refused for him to take away my joy and enthusiasm for life any more than he had already had. So I did what I had to do, and I forgave him. Tell us about that journey for you in arriving at that moment of forgiveness.
Yemisi, I mean, all of us will experience trauma in our lives, right? Whether it's the big traumas that we look at, like people will look at my story and be like, oh, that's a big trauma. But in my experience of life, I've yet to meet a human being who hasn't experienced some form or kind of trauma that has impacted them today. And so for me, what I realized is, I mean, at the age of 16, I was hospitalized, and when I got to the hospital, I remember the doctor said to us the following day after I'd undergone all this testing, the doctor said, you know, in my over 20 years of experience, I have never seen stress symptoms so severe in someone your age. And it continued with the words, your body is killing you. And if you don't change what you're doing, you're going to die. And that is when I got to that realization. And I mean, it was a few weeks later where I really started thinking about it. And I was like, oh my goodness, you know, me being angry at Eugene does not impact Eugene in the slightest, right? And I think that's for all of us. No matter who it is, our target of anger or anguish, it does not impact them. They continue to live their life. They don't stop breathing because you're angry at them. They don't stop living because you're angry at them. The only person who continuously gets re-traumatized is yourself. And so the realization I came to was that when trauma impacts us the first time around, that is what I call the first point of impact. And when we relive it in our minds and we keep, you know, having these visceral experiences of that pain, it happens again and again and again. And then that becomes the process of re-traumatization that we experience. And in South Africa, we've got a huge gender-based violence situation. And when I work with women who have undergone, you know, pain and suffering due to, you know, gender-based violence or rape or anything like that, that is what we always come to. What they'll say is, yes, the pain was, of course, the moment it happened. But the real pain, the real suffering that they continue to experience is in holding on to that and everything it robs them of in as they move through life. Now they struggle to be in intimate relationships, you know, they struggle to trust people, they're suffering with depression, they're on tablets, they, you know, so their whole life has changed because of this one incident. And I was no different. So as I realized this, for me, it started becoming a real effort to say, I refuse to be defined by this moment, and I am going to start taking control of my life. And I think that is a message I aim to help people come to an understanding of in their own lives. And that has really been the cornerstone of the talks I give and the work I do.
Mm. And do you think this system, when we think about the wider women, peace and security agenda, and what we're discussing now about the traumatic impacts, the lifelong impacts of violence and conflict on people, do you think the system and there's enough discussion around mental health? And do you think the system is set up to think primarily about the trauma of the victims?
No, and that is a great question, Yemisi. Thank you. I mean, when we're looking at especially women insecurity and we look at how women are constantly in a role of being portrayed as victims, right? I'm working on a project currently, which is to showcase that women are exceptionally strong. However, whenever we are looking at any sort of situation, women are continuously told how they are the victims, how they need to take more precautions to keep themselves safe. Yet I've never seen an advert in the world saying, men, you stay at home since you are the perpetrators, right? It is never the narrative we are told. And I know this thought became so prevalent in my mind, especially when something in the UK actually happened. It was a woman, I think, was taking a walk and she was murdered. And what was told to the news and to the police was, woman, stay at home. There's a crazy killer on the loose. And women started saying, why should we stay at home? Why aren't the men being told to stay at home? They're the ones hurting us. And I think as women, our mental health isn't being as prioritized as it should, right? Because whatever may happen to us, what I have realized in my experience is what people counter with is what you could have done to prevent that situation. You should have lived sooner. You should have done this. You should have done this. But it is never really looked at as how did this impact you? How are you moving through it? How are you processing it? And how do we ensure this doesn't happen again? Not in a way of, you know, telling women be afraid of the world. Because as we know, there are so many powerful women in the world. We see examples of it time and time again. You and I had a little bit of a conversation before this. And I even said to you, you are the representation of a powerful woman, right? And I think if those stories start to be told, then women will start realizing that, hey, I don't need to live my life as a victim. You know, I can prioritize my mental well-being. I can prioritize myself. I can prioritize my life because that is becoming the new normal. And I feel like for women, what has been the normal is work yourself to you until you break your bones. You know, you can carry everything. You are also a victim. Not only are you doing these, but you're also a victim to society. You're also a victim to this, that, and the other. And for me, until we can start shifting that narrative, we still have a long way to go.
Mm-hmm. Now, I want to go back to your experience with De Kock and your meeting of him. So you and your family met him when you were 23, you said, and you were surprised to find that you had empathy for this person who had had such a profound impact on your family, and which, like you said, led you to write that open letter to the South African judiciary system, ask for his parole, which he got. And I want you to summarize for us, not necessarily the contents of the letter, but your thought process as you're writing that letter. In the context of reconciliation, what did that process of meeting De Kock and writing that letter do for your processing of such a traumatic and violent time in South Africa generally?
I think it's very important to just note that before I wrote the letter, I didn't leave thinking, oh, I'm going to advocate, you know, for Eugene's release. And I also think it's important to note, like, why I thought that him being out of prison would be more serving to the world and community versus him being in prison. And so just to contextualize it, when we were still in the meeting, I remember we started having a conversation, you know, as we had met him and we'd forgiven him. And the one thing that kept on coming up was the missing persons unit. The person who was heading it kept on saying, you know, Eugene has been helping us locate these, you know, bodies of these people. And, you know, it's very hard because he's very limited because there's certain parameters we can't cross. There's certain places we can't go. And so it limits how much we can find. And so for me, I thought to myself, okay, he's already working with a missing persons unit. And if he can give more families a sense of relief or at least some sort of, you know, clarity, then why should we keep him in prison where he's doing as minimal as possible, whereas outside of it, he could be doing so much more to give people peace. And so when I sat down to write the letter, just coming back to your question, for me, it was just like I was expanding on a Facebook status I'd actually made, which was something I didn't even think of it. I only had like 200 Facebook friends. I didn't think it was going to be a big deal. You know, I was just like, hey, you know, for anyone who wants to hear it, like, you know, I just met the person who killed my father and this is my experience of it. And from that Facebook status, you know, I was asked to write this long letter. And as I wrote the letter, what I came to find for me was there were a couple of things I needed to address. One of which was, you know, as I sat down across this person, it was so much easier in my mind when I viewed him as a monster, as something that was outside of humanity, right? It was so much more difficult in me looking at him eye to eye and realizing this is just a human being. I am just as capable of the acts he committed as he is, you know? And I think for me, when I started realizing that all of us are one decision away from a different life, and all of us are just human beings that are constantly making decisions that allow us to narrate our experience. And so it shocked me that I managed to empathize with him and look at him and actually cry for him and be like, whoa, there's nothing this man can say to me that can free me from my pain, nor is there anything I can say that will free him of his. And so in writing the letter, there was that reflection, but there was also reflection on, again, history, coming back to the beginning of the interview, which is when we look at South African history, it's very easy to footnote it because the footnotes make a much better story. But when we really go into it, when we start to humanize Eugene and we realize this was not some rogue person who was operating of his own accord, who just hated black people. That was not the case, unfortunately. This was a man who served under the president, who had gotten medals of valor, who had been celebrated, who had been, you know, decorated. This is not some man who walked off the side of the road and decided to kill my father, you know? And I think when we put context into play, it changes so much of what we see. And I think with Eugene, right now, it is very easy to vilify him and call him prime evil, the assassin of the state and so on. But he was exactly that. He was working for the state. He wasn't a free agent. He wasn't a man who had gone, you know, above authority. Authority had approved these actions. Yet, the very authority that approved his action, which is the irony of life, is the one who got a Nobel Peace Prize and the other one got vilified and put into prison. So if we look at both of those accounts, we look at the complexity of my story and we look at the complexity of Eugene and F.W. de Klerk and we look at it in context and we say South Africa doesn't have a clean-cut history. And I think it is important that we look at it in context, as hard as that may be. So that was my journey and experience through writing the letter.
Negotiation and mediation between warring parties, between victims, survivors, and perpetrators of conflict is one of the central aspects to peace building. And I'm reminded of an interview I did with Betty Bigumbe, who led the LRA talks and peace talks with Joseph Kony. And one of my questions to her was, how was it like being with somebody like Kony who had committed so much atrocities and yet still been able to look past that and to look more in the context of the peace building efforts that you're trying to make? And it fascinates me thinking from your perspective as the survivor or the victim, let's call you a survivor because you are a survivor, of such an atrocity. So when we think about that in the context of processes of reconciliation, of negotiation, of mediation, what advice would you give to mediators when they're trying to bring survivors and perpetrators together in really achieving the objective of negotiating peace?
You know, I think it is one of those things that, especially as a mediator, right, it is so important not to come in with preconceived judgment. And I think that is the hardest part, because as human beings, we naturally carry certain bias and judgments no matter who you are. And I think if you want to facilitate a process between someone who is a victim of and the perpetrator of that pain, it is very important to come with understanding that each person experienced it, but they experienced it completely differently. Even the perpetrator has got his own viewpoint, he's got his own ideologies, he's got his own thinking around the very same incident. So when you just look at it and paint it as a brush of like, this is the evil part, this is the good part, I think you get to miss out on all this that could actually transpire. And I think it's just when you're a mediator, what you're really doing is holding space. Right? You're holding a respectful space between parties. And in order to do that in the most effective way, it is important that whether you're listening to what you perceive as the good or the right party, or the person who you believe is the evil or bad party, that you treat both of them with the same respect, and you allow both sides to articulate in the best way that they can without putting your emotions at the forefront of it, you know? And I think that might be one of the hardest things to do. And with the story you just shared, I think it does come down to, you know, she had to put her emotions and personal opinions aside in order to facilitate the best outcome for both parties. And I think sometimes we believe that when we operate from a place of emotion, then that articulates the fact that we are in, you know, we are completely against or opposed something. But the truth is, It has been proven time and time again that it is the calmest people within the eyes of a storm or in the eyes of a conflict or the eyes of an emergency that are successful, because it's about saying, I understand that this is an outrageous thing, or this is, you know, an evil thing or an evil act or an evil person, however you want to define it. However, in order to get the best outcome possible, I need to be so secure within myself and so stable within my emotional body that there's nothing this person can say or do that is going to waver me from my own core, because that's what happens in negotiation. If the other party sees that, oh, when I say to Yamisa, like, you're stupid, oh, she gets riled up. Okay, so if I can get her riled up enough and I can arise an emotion out of her, then she'll never get to the point of what this meeting is about. But when you have control over your emotions and you're like, okay, I understand, you think I'm stupid, you know, you think this, you think that, however, what we're here to discuss is this, you know, and that is always what will get the best outcome. And I think for mediators, it is exactly that, allowing yourself to have a strong enough core that you know that whatever may be said, you can still handle and you can still move past without having a visceral reaction to it.
In doing all these interviews, one of the things I keep thinking about is the mental health of the negotiators, of the mediators, which I don't think we'd speak about enough. And just remembering that behind all the officialdom and all the process and all the training is the human, you know, and the human that has a mind, that has thoughts, that has emotions. And I think that's something that really needs to be maybe talked more about in the process of, you know, mediation and negotiation.
Oh, yes, I couldn't agree more. And I think you bring it up so well, because I think as women as well, we are, again, you know, we're supposed to operate in the same way across the board. But like when you start paying attention to your mental health and you start having a stronger sense of well-being and core and self, then when you do enter these spaces, it becomes so much better for you to navigate and for you to then, once you step out of it, to also give yourself the space and the time to debrief yourself and to be like, okay, that was difficult. This was this. And you get to process it and release it instead of just sitting with it and pretending that it did not affect you.
Mm-hmm. So in the context of reconciliation of on post-conflict communities and from the perspective of young people, particularly young girls, what are your reflections on processes like South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission? Do they work? Are they done properly? What are your thoughts on them and how perhaps member states can rethink them?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And I think it's a question that needs to be looked more into. I think as the Truth and Reconciliation Commission that took place in South Africa, it was a beautiful process. It was an important process, but it wasn't a process without fault. And I think as countries look at South Africa as this beacon of overcoming and moving, I think it is also important to reflect on what we could have done better. And so what I look at when I'm looking at, you know, the Truth and Reconciliation Committee, and I'm looking at how it has then played out consequently, what I see is a process that took place at a time that didn't really follow through on what it was there to do. So at the time, it was great in order for people to feel seen, to feel heard, to feel acknowledged. However, as I look at how it has played out, you know, and now we are in 2021, still, so many people still have never been debriefed, have never had psychological help, have never been revisited to say, hey, you know, where are you now? How are you now? How has your family grown? You know, and I think especially with young women in peace and as they lead the charge on this, it is so important to understand that the process in and of itself cannot be looked at individually. It cannot be like, oh, for 2021, we're going to implement this process. This is a lifelong process because as we know with trauma, it is not something that happens and it can be contained. It is something that is passed through the thread of a family, right? So when we look at my story in particular, you look at the fact that my dad died. Yes, that's one part. But how did that thread spread into my whole family, right? His death completely destroyed a whole family. How my mother ended up coping, how I ended up living, how my brother ended up having to survive, how my grandfather, you know, so the whole family unit is destroyed by one moment in time. And that's not just for South Africa, that's across the world. And I think it's so important that as we look, we start incorporating, as we spoke about a little earlier, mental health. How are people's mental health, you know, as they go through these countries? And Yemisa, I think it's also important to say, when you experience these traumas, right, we can't look at them in isolation of a country. You look at, for example, in the context of South Africa, racial discrimination was our biggest issue. But then you get triggered when you go to maybe the U.S., and you still get treated as a Black young woman and you still face the biases and rejections and credit, you know, rebuttals and all these things that remind you of this trauma that you have just left behind. So when you're living in a world whereby so many structural situations have still not been fixed, how do we move past that? And how do we allow ourselves the space to acknowledge that I do live in a system that is not yet where it should be, and that is still triggering issues of the past? And how do we give people the skills and tools in order to not be fully impacted by these, but be able to change them and move forward effectively?
Thank you. Brilliant. Thank you so much, Candice, for sharing your story and your insights with us. Now, we've talked about your work, we've talked about your reflections around reconciliation, trauma, forgiveness. So to end the interview, I want you to tell us something interesting about you that we wouldn't find on Google.
Oh my goodness, something interesting about me that you would not find on Google. Okay, well then that would make me an interesting person. I'd have to be super interesting. But I think for me, what people may not know is firstly, I'm much more introverted than I show on my public spaces, number one.
Yeah.
And number two, I'm a complete dork. So when I find things that fascinate me, I am so into it. Like right now, my thing is astrology. And I don't know what it is, but I just, for the past 3 years, I've been trying to figure out if astrology can be used as an actual science.
Wow. Okay.
And you know what? Like as much as it's like very different from what we're discussing, I actually think it's actually a really great tool for human analysis. Usually when I meet people, I'm like, okay, where were you born? What time? What's your full birthday? Let me do a chart for you. Let's figure you out really quick.
Wow. So should we expect a book on this from Candice?
Oh my goodness. I'm sure it will be one of many that have nothing to do with forgiveness and reconciliation.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Candice. It's been a pleasure speaking with you today.
Oh, thank you so much for having me, Yemisi. This has been wonderful.
You have been listening to She Stands for Peace, the podcast series that explores the state of the women peace and security agenda in Africa, asking the central question, 20 years after UNSCR 1325, how far have we come? I am Dr. Yemisi Akinbobola, your host, and this podcast was produced by the United Nations Office to the African Union with the generous support of the Norwegian Ministry of Foreign Affairs.